There's a word from the Lord today to God's people everywhere. The people watching over the internet, and I understand there are some because they send me emails. One is telling me they heard the sermon and they watched the service. So we thank God for Brother Sean making that mechanism available for God's blessing to the people who can't come to church. God's word for God's people comes from the book of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles. Many times we think of Acts, we think it's the Acts of the Holy Ghost, and it is true that in the book of Acts, if you want to meet the Holy Ghost, if you want to see the things that the Holy Ghost can do and has done, you ought to read the book of Acts. It's all in there. But do you remember that right before he went to the cross, the Lord told his disciples to go to Jerusalem? My help is here, y'all. Thank you, Holy Ghost. To go into that upper room and just to stay there. Yes. Don't be anxious. Don't be discouraged. Just stay there. Because you will receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And so the book of Acts describes everything that happened after up to Pentecost, but after Pentecost. What's that got to do with you and I? Hold on for just a moment. We've lifted up this pericope, this chunk of scripture. And so every sermon needs a focus verse. I will share with you four verses from the Message verse version of the Bible. The Bible says, to begin with, that the temple police, the God police, the Holy Ghost, pew-jumping people, the priests, the chief, they got upset, the Sadducees, the people with the big crosses, the people who had to reserve parking spaces outside the temple, the people who could speak in tongues, the people who could put their tithe in the basket and not miss a beat. They got upset because Peter and John had the audacity to tell people about Jesus Christ. Just because you come to church don't mean you're in Christ. In my life, from this point forward, I ask God, even when I don't make it to church, let me be in Christ. Y'all quiet, let me get on. So they began to pray, and the Bible says that many people came to believe the message. About 5,000 people heard one sermon and got saved. If you will open your mouth and declare the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, countless thousands shall be saved. The reason they can't get saved is because we don't tell them the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me go on. So they locked them up overnight. They threw them in jail. Some of us are going to have to go to jail. Even on the way to church today, we heard about how in China they are executing people because they have a Bible. In the Middle East, you cannot even mention the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me bring it a little closer. In France, it is a secular nation. That means in 1953, France declared themselves to be a religious nation. They do have churches, but in the government, in their official meetings, you can't mention God, you can't mention Jesus. Let me bring it on a little bit closer. There was a young man who got straight A's. He happened to be an African American, but when he told, they asked him, what's going to be your valedictorian speech? He said, I'm going to give credit to the Lord Jesus Christ for helping me get a 4.0 average. And they told him, you can't say that. So on the night before his graduation, he got up and all he said is, I thank God. The principal reached up and snatched him down. It's happening, brothers and sisters, in just a little while. Where we live and where we work, then the God police are going to tell us. The authorities are going to tell us it ain't happening here. In our government, our money says in God we trust. But the Supreme Court says you can't mention God. Let me move on. All I'm trying to do is to tell you that to be forewarned is to be forearmed. Soon and real soon, this God-hating nation is going to rise up against the people of God. It happened to Peter and John. We better be equipped and prepared for it to happen to us. But the word of God says the next day they called them into the temple and they stood them in the middle of the room and they grilled them and said, who put you in charge? What business do you have doing this? But the Bible says at that point Peter was full of the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. And Peter cut loose. Is there anybody here who has been in a position where God told you sometime you got to stand up and be a witness? Be willing to cut loose, but all too often we run and hide. I don't want them to know I'm a Christian. I don't want them to think that I'm a Jesus freak. Peter did not care. The Bible says Peter, full of the Holy Spirit, cut loose. And the Bible says that they begin to question him. But then Peter said, listen, God, police, if you brought us here to trial today for helping a sick man, I'll be completely honest with you. We ain't got nothing to hide. From now on, we are going to declare the goodness of the Lord wherever we go. By the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the one you killed on the cross, the one God raised from the dead, this man stands before you healthy and whole. We don't care about you. We got to be about our Father's business. Now, for the next few moments, I'm going to try and make this relevant to us. I want you to consider with me on the subject our dynamic declarations. Dynamic. It comes from the Greek word dunamis. Dunamis. All dunamis means, brothers and sisters, is that power that nobody anticipated. That power that nobody can really harness. That might, that ability. We used to come to church and we used to sing the power. Power, there's power in the blood. Wondrous working power. Well, that's dunamis power. It's the power that allowed Jesus to endure temptations in the wilderness. It's that power, brothers and sisters, that Jesus told us he would give us to do the greater works. It's that power that allowed Jesus to give sight to the blind. This morning, we watched for a little while the canonization of Mother Teresa. And I'm not Catholic, but I can tell you the shame, the guilt and shame came over me. Because this little teeny woman who was 4'11" and weighed 89 pounds started out with 4 followers. And today, there are 4,000 sisters of the poor, all over the world. They work without recognition. They don't care whose name get called. They don't work for pay. They in Washington, D.C., it says when people are in hospice and there's no place else to go, they go to the sisters of the poor. And I thought about that power that must have been in Mother Teresa. I thought about how a man talked about this morning, how when she came in the room, she didn't have to say a word. She would look at you, and you would know that God was in her and that you were the presence of God. What would Baltimore City be if we had some of that dunamis power? So that when you walked in your job, all of the God haters would repent and be saved. What would Baltimore City be like if we had that dunamis power and we walked into the drug den or we walked among the gang members and we just looked at them and their lives would be changed? Doesn't say that Peter and John did anything other than tell them the good news. Doesn't say they had a megaphone. Doesn't say they called for revival. Doesn't say they took up an offering. Doesn't say they sold blessings. All it said was they opened their mouths and they boldly proclaimed the goodness of the Lord. Y'all looking at me like I'm crazy. Brothers and sisters, the Calvary ain't coming. The Calvary ain't coming. Ain't nobody gonna ride up Maryland Avenue, nobody's gonna ride up Charles Street or down St. Paul Street and transform this community. The reason why you and I are here is because God has already ordained that He will use each and every one of us to make a difference. But in order to do that, you need some dunamis power. Amen? You're looking at me like I'm crazy. Power, dunamis power, and explosive power. It's not weak power. It's that power that will change everything. It's that power that Jesus had. When the woman with the issue of blood, thank you, God. She said, if I can just touch the hem of His garment. And the homeless and broken people in this city are saying, if I can just get to where hope is, if I can just get to where healing is, if I can just get to where He is. But we stand between them and God. They don't smell right. They don't look right. They don't act right. They don't talk right. Today, brothers and sisters, God told me to tell you that He's sick and tired of pouring out His blessings on people who sit down on Him. Churches all over this country and all over the city are locking their doors. They're turning off the lights. If you don't believe me, go on the internet and type in churches for sale. Churches for sale. There are some magnificent and beautiful buildings over in Catonsville for sale. They're padlocked. The lights are out. Why? Because God says, I'm tired of giving my resources to people who don't give me anything into return. And God told me to tell you, Oak Street, if you don't start depositing in the heavenly, you won't have no return. Let me move on. In the New Testament, the word dunamis is used 121 times. And the Bible says that many times. People say, not me, Lord. But today, God wants you to ask yourself the question, if not now, when? If not you, who? If you don't do it, how is it gonna get done? Y'all quiet. I'm sorry, Lord, but I didn't mean to get off track. Brothers and sisters, my heart aches for 17-year-old boys, if you saw the paper, who are being charged with murder. In Baltimore City, my heart aches for 15-year-olds in Washington, D.C., who are charged with murder. And I said, God, what can we do? God said, well, who went to them? And who had the power of the Holy Ghost at work in them? Who had the dynamic power? Who told them the good news of Jesus Christ? Who walked them into their den? Who walked into their lives and said, young man, come here. Young girl, come here. God loves you and so do I. I was sinking deep in sin. Every day I remind the church that I was one of those kids. Sister Moody, if you talk to people in King's Apostles, I was voted the most likely not to succeed. When God showed up in my life, people looked at me and said, I know that God is real because of what He did in your life. We predicted many things for you. We thought you would have been in jail. That's the truth. We thought you would have been out there on the streets. But you didn't. We know that your mama and your grandmama's prayers have reached a harvest. But the number one problem in the church, I would submit to you, is that we as Christians forget all the dirt that we did before we got saved. And we forget, we ignore the dirt that we've done after we got saved. All I'm trying to tell you, brothers and sisters, is there is inside of you dynamo. There is inside of you the dunamis power of God. When you confess Jesus Christ, the greatest power the world has ever known took up residence in you. And already God has given you the ability to perform anything and everything that He has called you to do. You don't need more ability. You need God. You don't need more talent. You've already got the talent. You don't need more might. You've got the might that you need. What you need is to stop looking outward and turn inward and open up. and let the love flow. Back in the day, we sang the song, Turn On Your Love Light. Y'all remember that song? Today, the world is waiting on somebody to go out into a dark world and turn on their love light. That's what Jesus meant when he said, go forth and let your light so shine before men and women, boys and girls, that they will see your good works and glorify God. We get on down the road. In our scripture lesson, we see Jesus' disciples, Peter and John. Throughout the New Testament, before this point, they were vain and fearful. Do you remember how James and John sought to outmaneuver their fellow disciples? Do you remember how they sought to gain the places of greatest honor next to Jesus? You haven't known anybody like that? Not here at Oakland, but in some churches where you may have gone. Over and over again, the disciples' actions showed Jesus that they didn't truly understand who he was. Sound familiar? Even after 3 years with Jesus, Peter was afraid to confess Christ before a young girl. Read the Bible when you get home. It's one of the most perplexing passages of scripture to me. It's in Matthew 1:36, where the little girl confronted Peter. Big bad Peter. And Peter refused to confess Christ before a child. And today these young children are acting like adults. Today the young children are running the community. They're running the schools. They're running the neighborhood. Because you and I, as Christ-centered, Christ-focused adults, won't step to it. We run high. They don't mess with your kids. You know they're crazy. They're not crazy. They're confused. They're in pain. God needs that somebody to go forth and to tell them the good news. Now you say, about me, I don't have any power. Well, I want you to look at Isaiah 40:29 when you get home, where the word of God says he gives strength to the weak. And those who are powerless, he makes powerful. If you are weak-hearted, ask God to give you courage and then step forth. If you feel powerless, ask God to make you powerful. I gotta go. Something happened to Peter and John. Even through this pericope, the Bible says that these weak, faint-hearted, frivolous, phony, foolish individuals truly were filled with something. Something happened to them. The longer they walked with Jesus, the Bible says something mighty, marvelous, and miraculous began to transform their lives. This morning, Oak Street, you and I in the next few moments need to understand that if we're going to have a dynamic difference, if we're going to make a dynamic difference, if we're going to be able to go out there with a dynamic declaration, if we're going to be able that God has called us to be, we got to get up off of our rusty dusties. You got to turn off Oprah. You got to turn off the bold and beautiful. You got to stop being infatuated with the haves and the have-nots. You got to stop acting like your empire is down here and work to make a reality God's empire here on earth. I'm not trying to hurt you. I'm just trying to do something so that we can be available to God to make a difference, amen? And so as I wrap, I'll walk through this scripture lesson in the next few minutes and I'm going to race through. I just want you to understand that the word of God says, if you and I will just walk with Jesus, if we'll stop pretending that we have this thing figured out, if we just trust and obey, 4 things will happen in our lives that happen in the lives of Peter and John, and then we'll have that same dynamic declaration. We'll be able to go to work and make a difference. We'll be able to go into our neighborhoods and transform them. We'll be able to go into the jailhouse and the courthouse and set the captives free. 4 things that I'll go to my seat. The first thing that happens, look at verses 2 and 3 when you get home. In verses 2 and 3, the Bible says that Peter and John taught the people and they preached Jesus and the resurrection from the dead. The Sadducees got upset and they locked them up. But the Bible says many who heard the word believed, and the church grew 5,000. You see, the disciples who were formerly pitiful and powerless are now positive and powerful. In our scripture lesson, Peter was taken before the high priest, who said, "By what power and by whose name have you done these things?" And Peter said, "The Lord Jesus Christ." The first thing, you'll get a new attitude. You'll get a new attitude. Our attitude must be different because of his relationship with Jesus. The Bible says they received boldness and wisdom. That means a new attitude. They looked at their hands and their hands looked new. They looked at their feet and they did too. They had a new way of walking, a new way of talking. And they went out and won 5,000 souls for the Lord Jesus Christ. Count the number of people in here today and see how many people God could use us to change. They had a new attitude. I'm racing on. But the second thing the Bible says is in verse 8, where Jesus told the disciples, "Go to Jerusalem and stay there." Peter was filled with the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says once he experienced the Holy Spirit, he cut loose. How many times has God said, just open your mouth and cut loose. Just open your mouth and declare my word. Just open your mouth. But not me, Lord. I'm like Moses. I don't know fancy words. I don't know what to say. I got a speech impediment. I don't have the right education. I don't have the right title. All God says is open your mouth. It's not about you. It's about me. And the Bible says that at Pentecost, the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit came, and they got the dunamis power they need to declare. The first thing you get is a new attitude, but thanks be to God, the next thing you will get is a new anointing, a new anointing for a new day. The Bible says they weren't imbued. They weren't imbued. That means the Holy Spirit permeated. The Holy Spirit took over every aspect of their lives, body, mind, and spirit. Another word for imbued is pregnant. And today God said he's looking for a few people who are not willing to become being impregnated by the Holy Spirit. You see, a little bit of Holy Spirit is all right, but to transform the world, you need the full power. In the word of God, it says when Jesus got up from the grave, he got up with all power. He didn't get up with a little bit, and he didn't get up with some. He got up with all power. And Jesus said, all power is given unto me. And just as he gave it to me, I've given it to you, and I'm giving it to you. You will have a new anointing, and you'll have the ability to go out there and do what God called you to do. Do you remember the story of Daniel in the lion's den? They said, "Daniel, sorry, bro, you're fitting to be a feast for the lion." But Daniel went into that lion's den, and Daniel remembered the promises of God. And the next time you face your lion's den experience, the next time that hellion called boss, or that hellion called spouse, or that hellion called neighbor gets on your track, just remember the promises of God, that he will give you power and strength if you ask. You get a new attitude. You get a new anointing. But look at verse 9. Not only did they walk with Jesus, and did their walk result in a new anointing and a new attitude, the Bible says it produced new abilities. They didn't know how they did it. They just know they did it. They didn't use words. They didn't go with their Bible. They did not go with a big cross around their neck. They did not go with an offering basket. The Bible says they went in strength and power. They had the miracle working power of God at work in their lives. When you get home, look at chapter 3 of the books of Acts, where the Bible says that they walked past a crippled beggar. They walked past a crippled beggar. That's what got them in trouble. They had the nerve to tell a crippled beggar to get up and walk. And today, there are crippled beggars all around this church who are waiting for somebody to come and look at their situation and say, get up and walk. But if you don't do it, it won't get done. Today, brothers and sisters, the same power that allowed the disciples to heal the sick, to help the lame, that earned the rebuke of the Sadducees is at work in you and I. But we've got to understand that we've already been transformed. We keep on talking about when my change come. The change came 2,000 years ago at Calvary. The Bible says they stretched him high, they hung him wide. He hung his head and then he died. But that's not how the story ends, because 3 days later he arose again. And that same power that raised Jesus from the dead is available for us. In the Bible, in the Word of God, it says there will be a new outflow from your life. Out of you will flow living waters. I don't know about you, but I'm tired of being a never-ending stream. I'm tired of being a mud puddle. I'm tired of doing dirt on Monday through Saturday and trying to be anointed on Sunday. And so I told God to search me, to clean me up and to clean me out. I want some of that living ice water to flow out of me. I want to be able to go and make a difference in the lives of the people I profess to love. If you and I would stop playing with this thing and just get serious about our relationship with God, He's available. He's approachable, but God is able. He has already ordained and given you the ability you need. I'm done. We need a new attitude. We need an attitude adjustment. I need a new anointing. A new anointing for a new day. I need new abilities. My own feeble abilities and energies will not do what needs to be done to make this city different. But there's one more thing. You see, walking by side and trusting obedience with Jesus, a new attitude's important. A new anointing is important. New abilities are important. But there's one more thing, and this is the most important thing of all. If I were you, I'd go home and look at verse 13 and say, do it for me, Lord. Do it for me. Because the text says, and the Sadducees and the high priest saw the boldness when they saw how bold they were. These were uneducated. These were untrained men. The Bible says they marveled and they realized that they had been with Jesus. All I'm trying to say is because their willingness to walk with Jesus, to trust him, to obey, to trust and never doubt, Jesus transformed their circumstances and then he used them to transform the circumstances of 5,000 other people in a single day. Somebody said, well, it might take Jesus a little while. What difference does it make? I'm 65 years old. I need God to show up and show out. Even if it takes him the rest of my days, I just want to be used by him to make a difference in somebody's life. The Bible says, when the enemy saw them, their enemies let them go. Somebody missed that. When the enemies realized they had been with Jesus, their enemies let them go. When your nasty boss realized that you have been with Jesus, they're going to let you go. When the drug dealers realize they belong to Jesus, they're going to let you go. When all the God haters realize that you are God's child, they're going to let you go. What are you saying? I'm saying the most important thing, you get a new appreciation. You will have respect for them. The young people say, you better recognize. And today God is saying, if you will just walk with him, everybody who's an enemy of God will recognize. They will see God in you. And they'll say, I don't want to mess with that. I am fearful of the Lord opening up a 5-gallon can. And you know what? The Bible says that these two disciples became more confident. They became more convicted of their ability. They became more courageous. They became more committed. Today, somebody's got to understand that you can change lives if you will just stand up and be a witness for Jesus. Sometimes we look at our walk and we get discouraged because we've messed was a fickle. But today, church, God says he don't care about that. He's going to give you a dunamis declaration that will allow you to be fruitful. Today, Jesus is saying, don't give up. Don't turn back. Don't even look back. Just keep on walking and keep on talking. Keep trusting and never doubt. And I will surely bring you out. I'm going to make you a vessel I can use. I'm going to make you a healer I can use. I'm going to give you some hope. If you just stick with Jesus like the disciples, he'll renew, he'll restore, he'll refresh, he'll revive, he'll replenish, he'll resurrect, and he will revive. I don't know about you, but today I said, God, revive me again. Take me back. Take me back, dear Lord, to what I first believed. When I believed I could do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthened me. When I believed that nothing was impossible for God. When I believed that God, that the one who is in me is greater than the one who is in the world. Today I ask God, don't let the devil speak down. Help me, God, to keep on looking up. This morning, help me to do whatever I need to do to bring you glory, to bring you honor. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Savior, if you please, I am weak, but thou art strong. But God, give me a mouth that will go out there. And instead of cussing, instead of complaining, instead of criticizing, we'll call all sinners to repentance. This morning, brothers and sisters, somebody needs to know that God is just waiting. He's anticipating what you're going to do. The song that's in my heart is, would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Would you ever over evil the victory win? There's power in the blood. There's power, power, wonders working power in the blood of the Lamb. Today, Lamb, O Lamb of God, come and be with us. O Lamb of God, come and fellowship. O Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the whole world, give me a clean heart so I can serve you. Lord, fix my heart so I can be used by you. Lord, I'm not worthy, but if you just give me dunamis power, I will open my mouth and I'll tell it. In the city, I'll tell it in the subway. I'll tell it in the subway. I'll even tell it in the jailhouse. I'll tell it, I'll tell it, I'll tell it everywhere I go. This is the word of God for the people.
Renew my
we need to be careful about what comes out of our mouths. The power of life and death is in our tongue. We can speak life to these young people. We can speak love to them. I got a nephew in prison. But every time I write him, I remind him that Jesus Christ is able. And he has anointed me to preach the good news to those who are captive. And he always says, I look forward to your word, your letter, because it encourages me and it uplifts me. What would Oak Street be like if we wrote people who were incarcerated and just said, I don't know you? There's one thing, I said this before. I know a guy who said, you know, I used to get a letter from my mother and I always made me feel good. But then my mother's church started writing me while I was in prison. And he said that was what made me commit to being different when I got out. That's the power of love. That's the power of conversation, the Christian conversation. I'm just throwing it out there. I know people in prison who are eagerly awaiting the receipt of good news. If you don't write them and you don't call, who will? Let's get ready for communion. Let's get ready for communion. As you come forward.